Already, I've given you kind of a hint and a guesswork out there about the question about what the most famous and popular participatory sport in America is, say, in 1880. And you ask yourself, what's the most popular spectator sport? What's the most popular participatory sport? Is it baseball, for example? Well, the answer to that is no, it certainly is not. How can you do it when you've only got one league, either the American or the National, and I'm really not sure one? How can you do it when you've got teams that have names like the Cleveland Spiders as a choice of names? It's just not, it doesn't get there. Football, well, hardly anybody thought of football except as a short means toward homicide, so the answer is no. Basketball, well, it didn't exist. Chess, Calvin Ball, 43-man Squamish. What was the most popular sport of that day? Well, the answer is right here and as clear as you could ask for. It's politics. Not a question about it. Politics is the one sport that just about everybody, male and a lot female, indulged in the Gilded Age out there. And I call it participatory sport because it was. Hard to imagine today a time when 70, 80, 90% of the eligible voters would show up at the polls, but they did. And in Louisiana, on a good year, you could get 140% of the voters out there to vote. And strangely enough, always for the Democratic ticket, even in Republican parishes. Quite an achievement, quite an accomplishment out there. No, there's no question that Americans absolutely loved politics. You can see this in political cartoons if you try. You'll notice that if you look at a Thomas Nast cartoon, very often there'll be dozens of people, but no label to say who they are, no label to explain who that person with the face out there is. And there's a good reason for that, because everybody already knew. You know the players, you kibitz, you tell people how it works and the like. There are cigars named after candidates, the James G. Blaine 5-cent cigar out there. Remarkable kind of thing out there. You can get banners, you can get drinks, you can get sodas, you can get the whole magnificent works out of this thing. You can get campaign paraphernalia out there, like the campaign egg. You push a little button that says, I crow for Harrison and Morton. Those of you who have been troubled with your children playing kazoos. Kazoos were made first so that people could blow them during campaign rallies and make tremendous amounts of noise and squeakers and all kinds of things. You can buy yourself handkerchiefs that have your candidate on there and strike a great blow for your side out there. It's a magnificent kind of thing. Oh, it's so exciting. It's so much fun. And if you want to see politics, you don't have to go far. Because your newspaper, whatever newspaper it is going to be able to tell you everything about politics you wanted to know. The papers are in the hands of the party press. Independent press hardly even exists. Those of you who have your sense of unease, for example, about Fox News, had better realize that the standard kind of thing in those days is like the equivalent of Fox News. Fair and balanced toward one political party and out to put the axe into every other one out there. What does that mean? In any close election, you will find two sets of headlines for papers because every town is going to have two papers, one Republican, one Democrat. Sometimes several Republican that quarrel with each other. Sometimes several Democrat quarreling with each other. And if, in fact, that election takes place, you can guarantee that one newspaper, if it's a Democratic newspaper, will have roosters crowing on the front page. Victory! The people triumphant, it will shout. And, of course, on the other opposing paper, gigantic headlines, fraud at the polls. Well, I mean, that's the way it works out there. You can't expect, in fact, to have anything close to fairness. You're going to find campaign marches out there, campaign waltzes for your candidate, all kinds of things, songs made deliberately for the campaign of almost unspeakable terribleness out there of one kind or another. You will find campaign parades with marching clubs of wideawakes and phalanxes and guards and that kind of thing, all marching under kerosene lanterns or under Chinese lanterns of some sort in the dark of the night as fireworks go on. And all of these marchers there will have their own uniform for this purpose with an oilcloth cape out there because that kerosene does drip and it can do terrible things to your clothing. And you can buy them out there. Look at that. For compliment, Garfield and Arthur clubs. Aren't those gorgeous, those beautiful kind of things? It's so exciting. And if two parties' political parades run into each other on the line of trajectory, the fun is enormous, and every hospital in the city is going to have a full house. Oh, it's a marvelous kind of thing. So exciting out there. All of which would suggest to you that Gilded Age politics is something, man, wouldn't we like to get back to? Wouldn't we like to have something like that ourselves out there? And in fact, it can be added that people love that kind of stuff. Today, you're going to watch a campaign ad out there. You're going to look for a soundbite. But if you live back then, you know what a great day of a campaign is. Every town's going to have them, every city. That's the day when the orators for your party come to town. They're going to send off cannons in the early morning, maybe at about dawn. The moment the candidate's train comes in, or the speaker's train comes in, there's going to be little girls handing out violets to him on the platform. There'll be a crowd. He'll be carried cheering to the street, to the local hotel. He'll give a little speech on the balcony. And then everybody heads out to the park. Everybody heads out to the city green out there. There's going to be a barbecue. Food and drink for all, as much as they can stuff themselves with. It's a marvelous kind of thing. Unless, of course, the opposition did what it did once in Lexington, which is make sure to spike the barrels of alcohol beforehand with a very serious emetic. Most times, it turns out very, very well. It can be. Lexington is famous for many things, and that's one of them, it has to be said. Well, the fact of the matter is, you have the barbecue, and then comes the speaking. There's going to be a platform. It's going to be covered with bunting and flags out there, eagles beforehand, and you don't just get one speaker. You get two or three. And if your main speaker out there lasts for less than an hour and a half, you feel you've been cheated. You, the wife, the kids, the husband, the parents, all of them are going to be out there, some carrying picnic lunches out there. And you know what a speech basically looks like? I'll tell you what a speech basically looks like. A speech that a person's going to give out there, it doesn't look like what I've got right here. It probably looks like something like this. Oh, about this size. It'll be this is about 2-3 hours speech. You're a good candidate. You know how you do it. You basically talk. You spout. If something's going down cold, you skip to something else. If something's really working, you elaborate on it. Oh, it's so much fun. It's lovely. And you can always depend there's going to be hecklers from the other side in the audience. That's the way it works. And let me tell you, that's one reason why the audience is there. They want to watch the hecklers, and they want to see how you cope, how fast you are on your feet. That's the key. Now, some people aren't very fast on their feet. There's a story about Theodore Roosevelt, for example, campaigning in 1904. Maybe some of you know about this story. Theodore Roosevelt is giving a speech, so the story goes, and all at once from the back of the auditorium, there's a shout, "Hurrah for Alton B. Parker!" Well, Alton B. Parker, as some of you know, was the Democratic candidate for president, so unknown that nobody's written a biography of him from that day to this, and easily forgotten even during the campaign. Theodore Roosevelt stops his speech. He says, "My friend, who shouted Alton B. Parker?" Up gets a guy. "Okay, why did you say hurrah for Alton B. Parker?" Man says, "Because I'm a Democrat." "Ah, and why are you a Democrat?" "Well, I'm a Democrat because my father was a Democrat, my grandfather was a Democrat, and my great-grandfather was a Democrat." "Well, let me ask you, if your father was a jackass, and your grandfather was a jackass, and your great-grandfather was a jackass, what would that make you?" And the man cries, "A Republican!" Well, I mean, you get the idea. I mean, it's as simple as that. You have to be better than that. You have to think on your feet. Case in point, William Jennings Bryan, Democratic candidate, 1896. The golden-toned orator out there. The Matthew Harrison Brady of Inherit the Wind, which is a real slander on that man, who was a remarkable and talented politician of sorts. Okay, he comes to a small town. Republicans in the dark of the night have torn down the podium. There's no place for him to stand. What does he do? How does he give a speech? The answer is he has people drag in a farm implement, a manure spreader, stands on the manure spreader and says, "This is the first time I have ever spoken from the Republican platform." That's what you do. I mean, it's a wonderful kind of system out there. Or if you're like Thomas Brackett Reed, the Republican Speaker of the House, you don't just respond to hecklers, you bring them out. So right after the snapshot camera was invented, Thomas Brackett Reed throws it into one of his speeches, it has to be said. He starts out with his audience and he says, "If a photographic snapshot could be taken of the democracy in any time and place," he said, "it would reveal them in the act act of doing some mean, low-lived, and contemptible thing. Well, you can imagine what happened. The Democrats immediately began to boo and hiss, and Reid goes, see, told you so. Well, I mean, that's a talent. That's a gift out there. And you can see then why people are so enthusiastic about this. Not just people who support Thomas Brackett Reid, but you want to be part of it. You can see why at every election, people are going to vote as often as they can. It's going to happen. And you can have every chance at politics in the paper, even if there's not a presidential election on. You know why? Because up to the 1880s, every state chose its own state election day. So you have a presidential election year. Oh, yeah, the president gets elected in November. Oh, Connecticut chooses its governor in March, New Hampshire in March, North Carolina in August, Maine and Vermont in September, Indiana, Ohio, and Pennsylvania in October. They're kind of like polls in a day when there aren't polls, a tip-off of how well, how badly the party is gonna do. That's the reality of it out there. And the result is you can have politics all the year round. Imagine a world where the governors of New England states, each governor gets a one-year term and is elected every single year. That's what politics is like. Not surprisingly, then, American people love and engage themselves in politics, and they get excited. Now, this isn't true everywhere, it has to be said. You go to Vermont, for example, and there's not even enough Democrats to be appointed to the post offices out there. They go to a Vermont town, for example, and when the votes are all counted, it turns out, to the shock of everybody, that there were two Democratic votes cast in that entire town. Well, the moderator who's counting the votes immediately says, okay, well, the other person that cast a Democratic vote raises his hand. Well, nobody in the crowd does, and so he tears it up and says, we knew it must have been a mistake. Well, I mean, that's the way it works. But in most places, it's very competitive and very exciting, and people really, really like it. This is one reason why, in fact, when they refer in the newspapers to a quiet election day in Kentucky, they mean that only 5 people were killed that day. A really unquiet election day is the kind where they even shoot the governor or the elected governor, but that will happen a little bit later than that and a little after election day. And imagine this striking thing. This shows a picture of presidential nominees and candidates eager for the job, almost desperate for it. But imagine an America where actually wanting to be president and letting people know it immediately disqualifies you for the job. Isn't that a marvelous idea? Isn't that wonderful to think about? Because ambition, this is the way republics are destroyed. This is the way free government is destroyed. That's where you get a Napoleon, a Julius Caesar. You want somebody who doesn't want the job. That's the way it works. And so imagine 1884, an incredible year. You got a sitting Republican president, Chester Alan Arthur, made president by an assassin's bullet when James A. Garfield is killed at a railroad station. You got his former Secretary of State, who hates his very guts, a guy named James G. Blaine. You know what? These guys are the front runners for the Republican nomination, and neither one of them wants it. Neither one of them wants it. They're running. But I'm not saying they're pretending they don't want it. They really don't want it. And you know why? Chester Alan Arthur, why doesn't he want it? Well, I'll tell you why he doesn't want it. It's something that nobody knew. It's not because he just likes his sleep. He could always get that in cabinet meetings, as his cartoon suggests. No, it's a different reason. He's been to the doctor, and the doctor has informed him that he's dying. He has Bright's disease. It's a kind of a kidney, liver disease thing. He can't possibly live more than a year or two more. The presidency, another term, it's just crazy. It's out of the question. And Arthur knows it. He doesn't tell anybody. It doesn't leak into the press. Nobody knows about it until after he dies a few years later. But he doesn't tell anyone. And Blaine, for his own part, didn't want to be president. He had once upon a time, but you know, it's a real deterrent to wanting to be president. If you're Secretary of State and you're standing on the platform next to your best friend, James A. Garfield, him shot down and you're holding him there and his blood is soaking through your clothing. After that, you don't want to be president. You don't like the whole idea, but none of you would out there. And that's the story with Blaine. Blaine was convinced not only that this would happen, he also liked to hear, heard things that weren't true. For instance, When Charles Gâteau, the man who kills Garfield, he shouts, "I am a stalwart, and now Chester Alan Arthur is president." But Blaine imagines that what he said is, "My God, I meant to hit Blaine." Well, they don't sound alike, but that's what Blaine is convinced at the end of his life is true. Remarkable man. If I were talking about Blaine, I could fill up the entire time. He's the most lovable crook there is, except maybe Tim Sullivan, and Tim Sullivan is too young now to really rank there. Well, I use that as a point, because neither of these guys wants to be president, and yet they both run for the nomination. And they run because they're supporters. And Blaine's supporters loved him so much, they were often known as Blainiacs, could be said. The plumed knight, as he was often described. The champion out there. And that's what he looks like, in case you wondered. Rather nice-looking face, don't you think? I mean, out there, you wouldn't imagine that he sold himself to railroad corporations. The magnetic man out there, as this cartoon shows, a gigantic magnet bringing every kind of dissolute cause to his side. Well, the fact of the matter is, their supporters are basically saying to Blaine, look, if you don't run, Arthur's got it. You've got to keep him out of the presidency. And to Arthur, they're saying, look, you're the only guy that can hold off Blaine. You've got to run for the nomination, even if you don't want to. So you got two people who are the front runners for the nomination, and neither of them actually wants the job. In the end, of course, Blaine will get it, and Blaine will accept it. But in the middle of the convention, somebody who really didn't want the job was proposed. As a compromise that they nominate the great hero of urban renewal in Georgia, William Tecumseh Sherman. And William Tecumseh Sherman was in retirement. He's a war hero. Blaine's supporters think it's a great idea. Arthur's supporters think it's a great idea. And the word comes to Sherman, who's off in St. Louis, and Sherman immediately sends back a telegram. And you know what the telegram said. If nominated, I will not run. If elected, I will not serve. Isn't that exciting? Isn't that a wonderful way to do things? You think to yourself, this is the kind of politics you want. You want to find modesty even greater than that? Look at him. You've never heard of him before. His name is Horatio Seymour, governor of New York during the Civil War, Democrat. In 1868, Seymour is the presiding officer over a Democratic convention. The Democratic convention is deadlocked, ballot after ballot. Nobody can win. And then all at once, somebody gets up and says, I nominate Horatio Seymour. Well, Seymour, who's wielding the gavel, is appalled. He comes to the front and he says, my friends, this is a great compliment. I can't accept it. No, this is not for me. I'm flattered. I'm touched that you want me out there. But no, you're going to have to choose somebody else. And meanwhile, the party managers behind the scenes suddenly go, you know, this guy could unite the party. This guy could be the compromise. And they say, Horatio, will you come over here for a minute? Horatio comes over. They go, grab him. They grab him by the arms. They drag him out to a coach to get him away from the convention so the convention can nominate him before he says no again. Seymour doesn't want the job. As he's heading out, tears are streaming down his face. He turns to his friend. He says, pity me, Harvey. Pity me. I mean, you know, and if you think this is just a pose, let me tell you. In fact, it's not just a pose. Because late in October, it's clear that the Democrats are going to go down. It's going to be a really, really bad year for them, and they know it. The problem is their vice presidential candidate, General Frank Blair. I mean, out there. It isn't that Blair is a drunk, because of course he was. It isn't even that he was a mean drunk, which in fact he was. It isn't even that as a mean drunk he would make speeches, which he did. It isn't that he talked about Republicans plotting to force all good white women to marry black men, or that he called for using the army to make the Congress do what the president said, or prodded to go home with the bayonet, or that he had uttered the threat that if the Republican candidate won, he would never leave the White House alive. Oh no, it was just that it wasn't working. And that's the problem. And the effect of that was that, I mean, the Democrats were killing black voters down south as fast as they could, and it just wasn't working. Well, what do? There's 2-3 weeks to Election Day, and the heads of the Democratic Party, the National Democratic Committee, knows what to do. They got to dump Blair from the ticket. They got to drop him and choose somebody more harmless for vice president. And that's where they ran into a brick wall. And the brick wall was Horatio Seymour. Horatio Seymour, hearing that at least part of the ticket was going to be dropped, immediately informed the committee that if they were going to drop Blair, they really had to drop him too, because he didn't want to be their candidate. And so the only thing they could do then was keep running Seymour and Blair, because it was the only way to keep them in the race. Probably no candidate for president ever loved the idea of being out of politics as much as Seymour. Nobody really was happier at his defeat than Seymour was. Now, you look at that politics out there and you think to yourself, what a wonderful time. Why can't it be like that today? Gilded Age politics, we get so wistful for them. You better not. You better not do so. Have a real excitement about this kind of entertainment. But all this fun we're talking about, all these banners, all this stuff comes at a really high price tag, and you'd better see it. It's the price of partisanship. And every presidential race is going to show what that means. It's not just excitement, but the kind of passion that allows you to do anything that will work, anything that will win, any trick, no matter how dirty. Let's take a case in point, the 1888 presidential race. Nobody remembers the 1888 presidential race. Why should they? I mean, you know, the Republican candidate, Benjamin Harrison, grandson of William Henry Harrison, a little tiny man under his grandfather's hat that's too big for him in the cartoons out there that you can see, a hat that kept getting bigger and bigger as his presidency would go on, was a man that, as somebody said, he could take 10,000 strangers and by making a speech turn them into friends, and then make them all into mortal enemies just by shaking hands with them. He didn't have a personal touch, it had to be said. Well, he's the Republican candidate. And on the Democratic side, one of the most honest people you're ever likely to meet. Upright Grover Cleveland, who had so much backbone that it basically pushed him out in front. This guy is a workaholic. He stops work on bills and measures at 2 in the morning and says, well, let's knock off and call it half a day. That's a real achievement. A president who answers his own telephone, who answers his own doorbell, who answers his own conscience. A president who, later when he dies, long after the presidency, his last words are, I have tried so hard to do right. How can you really object to these kind of people as candidates? How can you make this into a virulent and violent campaign? But it was virulent, and it was violent, and it was savage. Point of fact, what you do with Grover Cleveland is, if you're a Republican, you latch on to the fact that he's trying to lower the tariff, the tax on goods coming into the country. And you warn that if that happens, England, with its industrialists out there, the great evil empire of the world, is going to undersell us, and it's going to put our workmen out of business, and it's going to lower our wages. You husbands out there, how do you feel about seeing your wives unsex themselves in the struggle for bread because they have to work to be able to keep the family going? How would you like seeing the pregnant mother sent into the factory, or worse, the whorehouse, to make a decent or indecent living because men are cut down to starvation wages or have lost any job at all? So what you're going to find in this campaign is that Cleveland's campaign is being funded by the English interest out there. And you'll find quotations from a magazine called The English Iron Era declaring that every good Englishman wants Cleveland to be re-elected for another term. Now, the fact of the matter is there was no such paper as The English Iron Era, so the quotations from it probably weren't genuine either. But that's all right, because a lot of papers that did exist had quotations that the Republicans passed out showing that England wanted Cleveland elected. Quotations had also been made up. That's the way you run this kind of campaign. And out west, what do the Democrats do in response? Well, they try to tie the Chinese pigtail to the Republicans, as they've done before. You elect Harrison, and California's going to be full of illegal immigrants, Asian immigrants, Chinese immigrants, the Celestial Empire, and so on. Now, what American worker can possibly compete with them? What American worker can live on nothing but rice and pies made out of rats and so forth out there? That's the nature out there. So you've got a campaign in many ways enormously dirty. And the final end of it comes with this guy right here, Lord Sackville West. He's the British ambassador of the United States, man by the name of Charles Murchison. Writes him a letter, and Murchison says that he was born in England, and he wants to know which of the two candidates to support. Sackville West had the two qualifications absolutely vital for getting a diplomatic post for England, one of which was he came from the nobility, the other was that he was really, really, really stupid. These things both are vital. And so he writes back, and he says, in answer to that, he says, in point of fact, that England's interests on the whole would be better off under Cleveland than under Harrison. Well, I don't have to tell you that there was no such person as Charles Murchison. I don't have to tell you that this was a Republican ploy to get the ambassador on record for Cleveland, because they knew that this would push votes to the other side, and that is exactly what happened, and that's how Benjamin Harrison won. Now, a lot of this may sound to you like politics as usual in the internet age, but an awful lot of the other characteristics aren't. For example, raising a great big campaign fund, in order to buy votes. How do you do that? Well, a Republican operative in Indiana sent out a circular letter to every county chairman out there. In point of fact, they had money to buy votes with, plenty of money to buy Indiana with. The only catch is a problem. People that you try to buy votes from may not be the most ethical in the world. They may not know that basic rule Senator Simon Cameron had. Simon Cameron once defined an honest man. He said, an honest man is one who, once he's bought, stays bought. Well, in point of fact, how do you do it? Well, Dudley, W.W. Dudley's answer was simple. He said, you buy your voters, and then you march them in blocks of five to the polls to make sure they vote right before they get their payoff. That's the way it works. And this letter was spread all over the place. Blocks of five. Models. Well, remember, there's no secret ballot in those days. You can get away with this. And if you think the national campaign that year was bad, and you'd have every reason for thinking that, all you have to do is look at the state level. You can go, for example, to Delaware. Fine little state, it could be said, as somebody once described it, a small state, three counties at low tide and one county at high, as it could be said. But what it's most known for is the buying and selling of voters, and the Republicans did a job this year out of Philadelphia out there, it could be said. Democrats didn't complain to the vote buying. What they complained was that the Republicans jacked up the prices so much. What the Republicans did was they paid top dollar for votes in the early morning until the Democratic campaign funds ran out, and then they bought them all at bargain basement prices. Now, that's dirty pool. It's really unfair, and it's the way it's done. As for West Virginia, Republicans knew they couldn't buy votes enough, so in fact, there were 12,000 more voters who voted than registered voters on the books, and they'd all come in from Republican states for the election. You think that's bad? You go to Mississippi, South Carolina. Nice, quiet campaigns. You'd like them out there. How could they help being that way when black majorities in both places were kept from voting Republican, or for that matter, from showing up to vote at all? At one ballot box, Republicans outnumbered Democrats by 2-1, but when the 100 votes inside the box were counted, the Democratic candidate for congressman won by 280 votes. Good math out there, really impressive, it has to be said. And in Arkansas, when the new legislature met, an opposition lawmaker rose up and said, it is a well-known fact. Then in Little Rock and Pulaski County, 9 ballot boxes from the Republican neighborhoods vanished and were found later the burned ashes and remnants elsewhere. Do the Democrats deny that fact? Up gets a Democratic legislature. This is an outrageous lie. 9 Republican ballot boxes burned. It's a base slander. The Republican gentleman knows that it was only 7 ballot boxes that were burned. That's the way it is. You want to hear something even worse? Louisiana. In Louisiana, the Democratic incumbent governor, it should be said, was denied renomination. And he was so angry that he decided to offer the nuclear option. He announced that Louisiana would be allowed a fair election. Well, a fair election means the Republicans will win, and the Democrats are terrified. The last thing they want is a fair election. So they buy him off by promising that if he supports the Democrats and blocks a fair election, they'll make him state Supreme Court Chief Justice, which is exactly what they did. And later on, they made him a senator because he'd had so much experience out there in a legal way. In other words, what we're saying is, very often, politics is very grubby, very messy, very nasty indeed. We had better not romanticize it. We'd better recognize that this is the case in just about every election. It's possible because, in fact, the parties print their own ballots out there, which is one way of making sure that when they go in the voting booth, they've only got one ticket they can vote from beginning to end, and they can't make a choice for themselves. That's how vote buying works. It's as simple as that. Stealing states, piece of cake. One voter in every 10 in New Hampshire, They're in the market. Someplace in New York City, it's like 2 in every 10. You go to the upstate rural districts, there's guys sitting on the fence by the polls at Election Day waiting to see which party's going to pay the most for them. They're known as floaters out there. It's a standard kind of operating procedure of one kind or another. You can do that in states as pristine as the land of steady habits, like Connecticut, whose most steady habit is selling and buying voters and counting Democrats out when they can. And if you want to look at these campaigns, you may think that this campaign already looks dirty, where people who are running for the nomination, it's alleged that their father had some part in the Kennedy assassination. I'm amazed he wasn't also accused of having being part of the plot to sink the Titanic. It's wonderful what can be found, but that's nothing compared to back then. You want to find dirt? You want to find grime? You want to find filth? It's out there everywhere. You can take General Ulysses S. Grant, a strong president, and look how many crooks he's holding up in various rings in the government out there. You can show him in cartoons, besotted on the throne, surrounded by bayonets, with the reformers out there pointing to the will of a people to overthrow him. You can show him as unleashing the wild animals with bayonets on their head to suppress free elections in the South. It's a marvelous kind of picture out there. You can show the American Republican danger of being thrown into the abyss by Grant and his crooked and drunken followers out there in the campaign, or tearing the heart out of the state of Louisiana in this rather crude and disturbing cartoon. This is the kind of stuff going. You can persuade people that Ulysses S. Grant as president wants a third term, that he wants to be a Julius Caesar and overcome the government so that he will indeed never leave the White House alive. And as for his opponent in 1872, Horace Greeley, well, Horace Greeley, the Democratic candidate, had certain handicaps, one of which is he'd never been a Democrat ever in his life. He once said that while it's true that not every Democrat was a horse thief, every horse thief was a Democrat. This is not a good analysis. I won't go into why he was nominated. But how do you go after him? Well, you suggest that when he talks about reconciliation, when he says, let us clasp hands over the bloody chasm, this is what he means. Clasp the black man clasping hands with the Ku Klux Klan over the bodies of his family. Clasping hands with the ghost of John Wilkes Booth over the grave of Lincoln. Clasping hands over the dead in Andersonville prisoner of war camp out there and the like. If you've got Horatio Seymour, Seymour knew what he was doing to not want to run in 1868, because the moment he gets the nomination, the Republicans will tell you who he was. He was the governor on the war. Remember the draft riots? Remember the riots in New York City when black orphanages were burned, when newspapers were ransacked, when the troops had to be called in to keep order, when there were lynchings all over the city? That's when Governor Horatio Seymour went down to New York and addressed the rioters with the very blood on their garments as my friends. Well, he never did anything of the kind. That's a simple lie out there, but it's believed. Look at him here as a kind of a devil, tempting the South away from peace and toward civil war. And that's not the worst of it. You know what people didn't know about Horatio Seymour? Republicans would tell you. Do you realize that every member of his family had died in a lunatic asylum? There's congenital insanity in his family. And have you noticed his eye? There's something about it, something, I can't tell what it is, a kind of a vagueness out there. You know what's going to happen? He'll get elected, the shock fit will be so great, he'll go crazy like all the rest of his family, and then Frank Blair will be president. Him, the one that's going to turn out the Congress with the bayonets out on. That's the way it goes. It's no wonder in 1872 that Horace Greeley would say that listening to the campaign against him, he didn't know whether he was running for the presidency or the penitentiary, as everyone can say. You look in 1884, James G. Blaine gets the nomination for president out there. He's shown as a great thief who'll rake everything in out there. We've got letters where he promised to make deals with corporations out there with little words on the bottom. Burn this letter, for example. And these are shown out there to show that this guy is a crook and nothing but a crook. You've got marchers marching, shouting, Blaine, James G. Blaine, continental liar from the state of Maine. Well, who do you put up against this guy? A person who wouldn't know how to put on a clean shirt even if he tried out there, because he doesn't know anything about honesty. A person who is tattooed with his sins out there, tattooed with his corruption, the tattooed man. And in case any of you recognize it, see that guy with the mustache right next to the guy with the spectacles, the guy looking kind of like this? Anybody recognize him? He's just a state assemblyman from New York, but anybody recognize him? Yes, T.R. as a young man. That's right. Troubled by Blaine, who he ultimately supported. Look at this. The tattoos are running on his own. Blaine can't beat his own record, as this cartoon says right there. You can see him here. The independents decided they couldn't support this guy. They had to have somebody honest. And so they nominated Grover Cleveland, that honest, upright governor of New York, that thoroughly honest individual out there. Except there was something they didn't know about him. And 10 days after the nomination, it came out in the papers. Turns out that the reform governor who had fought against Tammany Hall, who had battled against the crooked interests, a man who had forsworn all temptations, in fact, to try to become a great governor, out actually had a problem. He was a father. He was the father of a child, and he'd never been married. Her name was Maria Halpin, was the mother. Back 10 years before, he had been sheriff of Buffalo, and he had engaged in what we can describe as a liaison with Maria Halpin, it could be said. And out of this, a child came. Well, you know, this isn't a good thing to have a presidential candidate. It's kind of embarrassing and a difficult question. And, of course, the Democrats immediately try to cover up or say it's not true or try to find dirt on Blaine and the rest. And it goes to Cleveland himself, and Cleveland just sends out a simple message, and he makes it public. He says, tell the truth. And so what happens is people come up to Albany, and ministers, he says, I'm not going to tell you anything. You go to Buffalo. You investigate the facts. You talk to everybody that say they know these facts. Come back to me. I'll fill in the details. I know that when you go there, it'll vindicate me. You find out, and they go up there, and it turns out he is vindicated. It turns out that, yeah, he did have a child, apparently. But it might not have been his own child. Maria Halpin, well, she seemed to have shared her attentions with a lot of other people, has to be said, and including possibly his law partner, Oscar Folsom. And in point of fact, Cleveland wasn't sure the child was his, but he was the only bachelor there. And so he decided the grown-up thing to do is take responsibility for it, which in fact he did. Not too surprising. That when the election took place, the dirt goes on to election day, but Cleveland comes in by a squeaker, because it's very clear that when it comes to crookedness, Blaine will lie like a carpet. Cleveland will tell the truth every time, even if it's something that hurts him, he will not cover up. And the crowds then sang, hurrah for Maria, hurrah for the kid, I voted for Grover, I'm damn glad I did. Dirty campaign, no question. I might add as well that 2 years later, Grover Cleveland stopped being a bachelor. He married Oscar Folsom's daughter, Frances Folsom, out there in the White House, the first White House wedding on our record out there. And it was a very happy marriage. And I might add that when their child Ruth was born, according to legend at least, that's where the baby Ruth candy bar comes from. So remember Grover Cleveland, if you can, with some kind of honor. About it. The campaigns out there are dirty, and it's not just personal, and the personal is out there. It's the allegation of the other party is a threat to the American Republic, a threat to freedom. You elect the Democrats in 1876, and you're bringing back the Confederate Brigadiers. And if you're Oliver Morton, the senator from Indiana, this is what you'll tell audiences. Every slave owner that ever lived was a Democrat. Every rebel that fired upon you in war was a Democrat. The man who shot Abraham Lincoln was a Democrat. The men who spread yellow fever and terrorism and burned hotels in New York in the war were Democrats. Soldiers, every bloody, every scar you have on your body was given to you by a Democrat. That's the kind of language. It's out there. And so what you can see again and again is that with this kind of language out there, if this Democratic candidate Samuel Tilden talks about reform, the cartoonist shows this is what reform means. The massacre of black people by white people in Hamburg, South Carolina. This is democratic reform. This is what you will get. I don't have to tell you that you don't have to be a major party to be paranoid, to think that the British are out to get you, or foreigners are out to get you, or the Chinese are out to get you, or the South is out to get you. You can belong to a small party and you can believe it's the Rothschilds out to get you, or the international banking conspiracy, or the Jews, or whatever thing you want. It's all out there. It runs as a current through public life. Like that politics that much anymore? You feel good about what you're seeing there? Well, I don't think so. You've got every reason not. You may say to yourself, in 1880 or 1884, the two major parties are so rotten, They are so crooked. They're so unscrupulous. I'm going to vote for a minor party candidate. I'm going to pass a protest vote for the Prohibition Party, led by Governor John P. St. John of the state of Kansas. That's what you'll tell yourself. Of course you will. Except in point of fact, what you don't know is that John P. St. John's Prohibition Party is really a front. It's being bankrolled by the Democrats, because they know that every prohibition vote came out of the Republican Party. And the Republican Party in 1884 tries to buy St. John off. You know why they can't do it? They can't do it because they can't raise the money. And you know why? Because they're bankrolling another third party, the one run by Benjamin Butler out there, the Labor Party. And they don't have enough money to buy two parties off at the same time. It's a striking kind of quality out there, a disturbing kind of character to politics. And this happens again and again out there. The politics out there, it doesn't look so pleasant, does it? And for those of us bothered by money today, the size of money back then weren't that big. Bucks, if each party has to put out its own votes and print them, you think about that. You got 200,000 voters in New York, and you're going to have to print out approximately 2 to 3 million ballots, because some of them get lost, some get handed election day. They're paper ballots that you're going to hand out. It takes money. These campaign parades, they don't go on for free. The fireworks, the barbecue, the butcher's bill out there, all of this stuff has to be paid. And that means if you want to raise money, you're going to have to do it one of a few ways. Take down federal and state employees to make them pay. Basically, your money or your desk. It's like a highwayman's thing. And you nominate candidates that can provide you with money who've got a barrel out there. In fact, you take the Greenbacker Party. The Greenbacker Party hates big, rich men. They hate the monopolists in finance and business. They want to get back to a people's currency. And who do they nominate for president? A millionaire, Peter Cooper, because it's the only way they can get the money to run a campaign. It's there out there for his money. Or you look at this guy here, William English of Indiana. Nobody would nominate him because they liked him. He's a banker. He forecloses on widows' mortgages. He's a hard-hearted, grasping, mean guy. Why would you nominate him as a running mate on the Democratic ticket? Because he has a barrel, because he has money, and he can look over the graves of all those people he's foreclosed upon if you want to out there. The fact of the matter is, you need him. And look at this unlovely character, Samuel J. Tilden, governor of New York, reform governor and the rest. But the big story is, he's got money. And you need the money to run the Democratic campaign. He may be ailing, he may be sick out there, but that money can buy votes. That's what you got him for. And that means that even 8 years after he defeated for president, he's still a leading runner-up. Everybody that goes to visit him will tell you the same thing. They'll tell you the same thing. They'll say, look, he's sick, speak, he's an invalid in a chair, he's hopeless, he's rasping, he's at death's door. You can't make him president. And the answer comes back, okay, we need his money, we'll nominate him anyway. We can have, other Democrats do the work. And they say, but look, the shock of being elected president will kill him. And the answer to that, the one Democrat says, it's all right, we'll cover it up. We put him on ice until Inauguration Day. We pretend to swear him in, and then the vice president takes over. I mean, that's what the desperation of money is about. It's crazy out there. And that means that Senate seats, the same way, are being bought and sold in the marketplace. Candidates running are buying their place in government and the like. And the bought vote, North and South, knows no racial lines. Any kind of person is in the market, and that's what the money does. So we're saying that the ballot box gets kicked around and kicked around very plentifully. You ask yourself with all this vote buying, this mudslinging, these third parties as front, this ballot box stuffing, what could be worse? You know what could be worse? Elections in the South. Because in the Democratic South, everything you saw in the North is there, added to a strain of violence and murder and intimidation. We're talking essentially about a South where before a Louisiana election, 3 or 4 days, so the news can get around, maybe 5 or 6, maybe a dozen black bodies are fished out of the local bayou out there, having been beaten to death, maybe. We're talking about a South where an opposition news editor will be dragged out by masked men and flogged with barbed wire. We're talking about the dynamiting of opposition press offices. We're talking about threats against any white man that dares to cast a Republican vote. And we're talking about race baiting of the most blatant and ugly kind out there, that if you vote for Republicans, you are voting for the sugar interest and for Sambo out there. Look at these kind of pictures out there of what it means to cast a Republican ticket out there as opposed to a white man's ticket. If this kind of stuff doesn't make you appalled and horrified and sickened, then in point of fact, you can't be sickened at all. That's the story of politics at the end of the century in the South. That's where a one-party system comes from. We'd better see that very clearly. And if you put all these things together, what kind of election do you get? The second worst and most disastrous presidential election in our history. In 1876, no, I'm not going to tell you what the first one is unless somebody asks me that out there, but the presidential election, Samuel Tilden, the Democratic candidate, goes into election night and it looks like he's won. But in the morning, it turns out that in three southern states, still held by Republicans at that point, Hayes gets the electoral vote by, shall we say, creative counting. And Hayes wins by one electoral vote. Well, the Democrats know that Samuel Jones Tilden has been had. If this guy always looks as if he smells something bad, he smells something bad. The Democrats know that they stole the South fair and square. And now it's being stolen back from them. They shout Tilden or blood. They shout that they're going to have revenge. Their editors out there, like the editor of the Louisville Courier Journal out there, Henry Watterson, is filled with the promise of 100,000 unarmed men marching on Washington to see that by the eternal Tilden gets elected. But as a matter of fact, the Democrats don't dare carry through with it. Because they know that if you investigate really clearly, you'll find that there were attempts to buy off the vote counters in Florida, in particular. Before it, and the orders come from it, came from Tilden's own house in New York. Oh no, Tilden knew nothing about it. I know nothing, nothing. He'd seen nothing. He insisted it was his nephew that did it. He was shocked, shocked to find that such manipulation was going on. But the fact is, out there you can see, this man is not a candidate you'd support. So both sides are uncomfortable about it. Both sides know that their election is tainted. What do? Well, you work out a deal. And the deal that you work out there with the two parties, either with no head or on the other hand, too many heads, if it's the Democratic Party out there, they agree on a special electoral commission. Five members of the House, which are Democrat, five members of the Senate, which are Republican, and five members of the Supreme Court, which, as we all in Florida know, is always known for its unbiased judgment in presidential elections. Case, you got two Republican judges, two Democratic judges, and a guy that's right between the two of them named David Davis, who the Democrats decide to sweeten by electing a senator of Illinois, whereupon Davis immediately resigns from the commission, and the only person they can put on is another Republican. Seven, the vote is to count the Republicans in. That is this election. The Democrats have trapped themselves. Tilden could have asked for civil war. It had happened before in the worst election. But Tilden was also a man of peace and a man of law, and he was willing to be counted out, unfairly though he was. And his successor, Rutherford B. Hayes, a good man, would be known as his fraudulency throughout his entire term. Another victory like this, say the Republicans, and I am undone. Well, all of that means, in point of fact, that out there is one of how far the American political system can go. And in the wake of the Tilden election and defeat, the Democrats in South Carolina and Florida and Louisiana make sure it will never happen again. You use bulldozing, you stuff the ballot boxes with tissue ballots, and you make sure that the Republicans will never have a chance of winning in any southern state again. You use force, you use violence, you carry every election. The election of 1876 isn't the only stolen election, it's the first. And every election after that, as far as the Democrats of the South can carry it, is stolen. That is the reality. That is the truth. So what we're saying right here should be pretty clear to all of you. If you people have a sense of sentimentality about this world out there, get rid of it right away. If you're wistful for this time, you'd better stop being wistful. Looking at our own political circus and comparing it to theirs out there, We can't help feeling wistful. I certainly do a lot of the time. I mean, how much better? I mean, how much more fun theirs was. We can almost smell the barbecue and hear the brass bands and the kazoos. We long for the savor of cigars from the smoke-filled rooms of conventions where, even if the politicians didn't give us another Washington or Lincoln, they gave us somebody so harmless that today 9 in 10 people can't even name them. But again, before we make a vow to make American politics great again, let's remember it right, shall we? The tissue ballots, the splattering of blood at the polling places, the midnight visitors at black cabins on election eve, the fantasy nightmares and boogeymen that gave voters the creeps and never were, the stories about presidents planning to be kings and vice presidents plotting to kill their running mates, the many ways that money then, as money now, made politics a mug's game, where insiders always had the inside track. Politics is a messy business. Always a messy business. It can't help being a messy business. But before we look around us in despair, perhaps we should look back and feel more hope in our own time. It's worse today. All of us must be maybe better off, and some of us are certainly much better off. The Disney World, the age politics. Thanks very much.